So, last 2 weeks, we were discussing from chapter 5 of Third Canto, wherein Maitreya Rishi is explaining to Vidura about the process of creation, how the universe has been created by the Supreme Personality of Godhead in his Swamsha expansion known as the first Purusha, Karna Daksha Vishnu or Mahavishnu. So, how he creates, that has been described in the last class. We saw that the pradana or avyakta or prakriti comes out of the skin pores of Mahavishnu, and by glancing over glancing over pradana, Mahavishnu impregnates her with kala shakti and jiva shakti. Then that prakriti or pradana transforms into 24 elements, starting with mahatattva, then sutatattva, then ahankara, then in the mode of goodness, mind and all the variety of devatas appear who will be supervising all the senses and external and internal senses. And then from the mode of passion, there appears intelligence, prana, and then 5 jnanendriyas and 5 karmendriyas. And then from the mode of ignorance, there appears ether, not sound. From sound, there appears ether. From ether, then appears touch. Then the vaya medium, air. Then there appears form, along with the vaya medium, fire or light. Then there appears taste, along with the vaya medium, water. Then there appears the fragrance, along with the vaya medium, earth. So like that, the 24 elements, along with prana and sutattva, there appeared all of them. And the 14 devatas, the 10 devatas are the 10 senses, and the 4 devatas are the 4 internal senses, man, buddhi, ahankara, chetana. The 14 devatas, who are an expansion of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Ete Deva Kala Vishnu, they're actually empowered representatives, are the fraction of the fractions of his expansions. They are actually offering prayers to Lord Vishnu in order to get the knowledge and empowerment to be part of Lord's service. So, Lord, the Supreme Lord, with an intention to create the universe, has created these 24 elements along with their precedent deities. Now they are requesting the Supreme Lord to engage them in Lord's service. So we discussed 3 prayers from the devatas, and today we will discuss the remaining prayers, wherein they offered prayer saying that Namamate Deva Padarvindam Prapanna Tapopa Shamata Patram Yanmula Keta Yatayonja Soru Samsara Dukkam Bahirutshipanti. So we'll offer our prayers unto your lotus feet. We surrender to your lotus feet. Your lotus feet act like an umbrella for the living entities who are suffering in the tapatrayena, 3 types of material miseries, adhyatmika, adibhautika, adidaivika. They are like the burning sun of the midday of the summer. So in order to save ourselves, we need to get into the shade of a umbrella. So Lord's lotus feet is like an umbrella, atapatram, it is umbrella, which is giving cool shade, simultaneously throwing down the water droplets, cooling water droplets, by which the person gets relieved instantly. That is what they said. And then they said that Datar Yadasmin Bhava Isha Jivas Tapatrayenabhihita Nashrama Nasharma Atam Atman Labante Bhagavam Stavangri Chayam Savidyam Ata Ashrayema. Those whoever comes into the shade of your lotus feet, for them, getting relieved from this material world and entering into spiritual world is very easy. But for others who are following after jnana and yoga, other process, it will be very difficult for them because they have not taken shelter of the shade of your lotus feet. So it will be difficult for them. And then finally, but there are some jnanis and yogis who have actually understood the glories of your lotus feet. They actually take shelter of the Vedic literature, which are actually spring forth from your lotus mouth. And following the instruction of the Vedic instructions, the Vedic literature, they actually come to the shade of your lotus feet. So that is explained with the help of an analogy. A tree is considered to be the Supreme Lord. The root are the lotus feet of the tree, at the feet of the Lord, and the entire trunk is the feet of the Lord, in which there is a nest, in which the birds are living. The nest is like the mouth of the Supreme Lord. In the morning, the birds get out of the tree and go to the paddy field to get the grains. So in the evening when they are returning, the people who are actually traveling on that path, seeking for a shelter in the night, they actually follow the path of the birds. When the birds go back to the nest, the people come and took shelter at the feet of the tree, because they understand that the birds generally stay in the tree where the tree is located nearby a water body. So they will have the shelter along with the water. So similar, just like the mouth of the Supreme Lord emits the Vedic instructions in the form of Vedic literature. So reading them, understanding them, and following the instructions of the Vedic literature, like jnanis and yogis, go back to the feet of the Supreme Lord. That is where they take shelter in the night, like the pilgrims who take shelter at the base of the tree. So this is for the jnanis and yogis. But devotees, they don't have to struggle so hard. They, just by taking shelter of the Ganga, which is actually emitting from the lotus feet of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, they actually completely surrender to Supreme Lord and go back home, back to Godhead. Here, the one understanding is that taking shelter of Ganga is like taking shelter of Lord's lotus feet. That is, the Lord's lotus feet is nothing but taking shelter of the pure devotees of the Supreme Lord, who have already taken shelter of the Lord, shelter of the Lord's lotus feet. So taking shelter of Ganga is like the emanation from Lord's lotus feet, that which belongs to Supreme Lord. That is Ganga also, and also the pure devotees. Taking their shelter, anybody, any person who is suffering in this material world can easily go back home, back to Godhead. So that is the understanding. So with this prayer, we stopped last week. And then the devatas further continue praying all the way till the end of this chapter. So we'll see through the remaining prayers. So here in the 42nd verse, they are saying that Yashraddaya shrutavata cha bhaktya samrajyamane hrudayavadaya jnanena vairagya balena dhira praje matatte ingri saroja peetam.
Simply by hearing about your lotus feet with eagerness and devotion, and by meditating upon them within the heart, one at once becomes enlightened with knowledge, and on the strength of detachment, one becomes pacified. We must therefore take shelter of the sanctuary at your lotus feet.
So in the next two verses, the glories of bhakti are described. 42 and 43 talks about the glories of bhakti, and then how this bhakti can be of great help to the non-devotees also. That will be described in the following verses, 44, 45, 46, etc. So now in these two verses, just like in the previous verse, Ganga, devotees by surrender to Ganga will go back, home back to Godhead and easily reunite with the Supreme Lord, that is being discussed. So what is the, how they will attain this? How they will attain shelter at the lotus of the Supreme Lord? What is the process prescribed in the Shastra for devotees? That is being described in this verse. Ya, Shraddaya, Shrutavata, Cha Bhaktya, Samrajyamane, Hudaye, Ava, Daya. So basically it says that Shraddaya Shrutavatya, these devotees, actually they hear the discussions about the Supreme Personality of Godhead from the mouth of pure devotees with complete faith, with utmost faith. They don't listen to the devotees of the Supreme Lord superficially. They actually have complete faith that hearing the subject matter will take us back home, back to Godhead. So with that faith, they actually hear Krishna Katha from the mouth, from the lotus mouth of the pure devotees of the Supreme Lord. Then, Bhaktya Samrajyamane Hrudaye. So by hearing such talks of the pure devotees and by engaging in different angas of bhakti which were instructed by the pure devotees, their heart is completely purified. Samrajyamane. So this is a very famous festival. We all take part in it as much as possible, like Gundicha Marjan. The day before Ratayatra, all devotees go to Jagannath Puri and then they enter Gundicham temple, and they, whatever way they are, it is possible, they actually take part in cleansing the temple of Gundicha, that is called Gundicha Marjan. So same way, Samrjyamane Hrudaye, the heart is completely purified by execution of various limbs of bhakti, starting with hearing. Avadaya, then in that purified heart, there appears jnana and vairagya. Jnana and vairagya immediately takes place in the purified heart by the execution of different angas of bhakti. So this jnana and vairagya are not like jnana and vairagya in general sense. This is a specific understanding of jnana and vairagya in relation to bhakti. If you all remember, in the first canto, second chapter, verse number 6 and 7, these two verses are considered to be the definition of bhakti, practicing which pleases the heart of the practitioner. Savai pumsha paro dharma yato bhaktir adokshaje ahetuki apratiyatha eyatma suprasiddhi. So that is the definition of bhakti as per Sutta Goswami. And then by executing this bhakti, what will be the result for the practitioner? That is mentioned in the next verse. Vasudeve bhagavati bhakti yoga prayojita janayati ashu vairagyam jnanam chayat ahetukam. So by practicing this bhakti unto Lord Vasudeva, without any reason, there appears jnana and vairagya. So from normal point of view, one may think that jnana means the knowledge of this world, knowledge of the distinction between Atma and Paramatma. So that we may think. And vairagya may be the detachment from the worldly things, the worldly minded people, the material world, like that we may think. But Acharya has explained at various places, when they translate this verse, they say that jnana means the experience or the understanding of transcendental position of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Not the simple understanding of this world is, what the material body is, what the Atma is, how the Atma is different from the body. Not that understand, that knowledge. Here this jnana refers to the complete understanding of the position of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. The knowledge in relation to Supreme Personality of Godhead, that jnana will be revealed to the devotee whose heart is completely purified by the execution of 9 limbs of bhakti. And then vairagya. Vairagya is indifference to other processes that have been mentioned in the Vedic literature. Indifference to sakama karma, nishkama karma, jnana yoga and ashtanga yoga. They become indifferent to these processes. Though the people of this world are very enthusiastically practicing sakama karma, nishkama karma, jnana yoga and ashtanga yoga, but the devotees whose heart is completely purified by the execution of 9 limbs of bhakti are not at all interested in performing those things. They are only interested in executing the 9 limbs of bhakti. So this kind of devotee can be called as completely surrendered devotee or akinchana bhakta. So as Lord Krishna indicates in the Bhagavad Gita at the end, as charma shloka, complete surrender. So he is completely surrendered or sold out to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. He has nothing to do with anything else in this world. So that kind of person. So in his heart, which is already purified by the execution of 9 angas of bhakti, there appears jnana and vairagya. Now it says that by the strength of jnana and vairagya, this person becomes dhira, firmly determined person. Matlab, he goes beyond the stage of nishta, ruchi and asakti. Here dhira can be taken to the firmly conviction on the process of bhakti. With the complete realization of the sweetness of the Supreme Personality of Godhead and being indifferent to other processes that are recommended in this world for the people of this world. So then what happens for that person? Vrajema tattengri saroja peetam. This person very easily go and become an eternal Lord, Supreme Personality of Godhead under the shade of his two wonderful lotus feet. So this is the glory of devotional service. When one executes devotional service with utmost faith and utmost surrender, one will go back home back to Godhead and take shelter under the shade of the Lord's lotus feet. So that is what is the meaning of this verse. This verse and the next verse both actually glorify the greatness of bhakti. So Prabhupada actually writes in the Parapat, the minds of materialistic persons are so disturbed that it is almost impossible for them to search after the supreme truth by personal regulative endeavors. But even such materialistic men, with a little eagerness for hearing about the transcendental name, fame, qualities, etc., can surpass all other methods of attaining knowledge and detachment. So Prabhupada says that if one has faith in the subject matter of Krishna, so by hearing Krishna Katha, one very easily purify one's heart and attain the shelter at the lotus feet of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Of course, this is the medicine which Sukadeva Goswami administers to Parikshit Maharaj at the very beginning of the second canto. So ultimately, Parikshit Sukadeva Goswami says that, my dear Parikshit, for you, the suitable medicine is to hear Srimad Bhagavatam. Pibantiye Bhagavata Atmanam Sata Kathamrutam Shravana Putech Samrutam Punanti Te Vishaya Vidushitashayam Prajanti Tatcharana Saroru Hangitam. The same thing, whatever was mentioned in the second canto, second chapter, 37th verse, is again repeated in this verse. So that is how bhakti acts and the people of this world. So Prabhupada defines the definition of Dhira. A person who is not disturbed even in the presence of cause of disturbance is called Dhira. So this person who has completely surrendered to the lotus feet of Supreme Lord, surrendered to the execution of nine angas of bhakti, that person is not at all disturbed, because that person has complete faith on the assurity given by the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Ma suchaha sarvadharman parityajya mamekam sharanam vaja aham tvam sarvapapebhyo mokshayishyami ma suchaha. He will never lament. He will have faith, our complete faith on the Supreme Personality of Godhead's words. So that's it. A devotee of the Lord becomes an elevated dhira by the simple process of meditating in eagerness on the lotus feet of the Supreme Lord. Devotional service entails being initiated by a bona fide spiritual master and following his instructions in regard to hearing about the Lord. Such a bona fide spiritual master is accepted by regularly hearing from him about the Supreme Lord. The improvement in knowledge and detachment can be perceived by devotees as an actual experience. Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu strongly recommended this process of hearing from a bona fide devotee. And by following this process, one can achieve the highest result, conquering all other methods. So this is what Prabhupada writes and glorifies the process of bhakti. And the same thing is continued in the next verse. The process of bhakti further glorified in the next verse. Vishvasya janma siddhi samyamarte kṛtāvatārasya padāmbujam te vrajema sarve sharanam yadīśā smṛtam prayacchati abhayam sapumśām.
O Lord, you assume incarnations for the creation, maintenance, and dissolution of cosmic manifestation, and therefore we all take shelter of your lotus feet because they always award remembrance and courage to your devotees.
Yeah, here again the glories of his lotus feet are mentioned. Vishvasya janma siddhi samyam arte krutavatarasya padambujamte. So krutavatarasya, in order to create, maintain and annihilate this universe, you appear in various avatars such as three Purusha avatars, Karmadaksha Vishnu, Garbhadaksha Vishnu and Shirodaksha Vishnu. And also, in order to maintain the people of this world, you also appear in various other incarnations in the form of Masya, Kurma, Varaha, Narasimha, Vamana, Parashurama, Rama, Dhanvantari and other avatars like Parashuram, Krishna, Vyasa, Buddha and Kalki. Like that, various avatars you keep appearing again and again. So, and also in the material world, you also take the avatars such as Guna avatars, Brahma, Vishnu, Shiva, in order to locally observe the activities of this universe and take care of them. So, because you appear in various avatars and perform various pastimes, we have so much to hear about, so much to describe and so much to meditate upon. So thus, we can always meditate about your lotus feet. Prajema sarve sharanam yadisha smrutam prayachati abhayam supumsham. So when we remember all the variety of pastimes that you perform when you appear in various avatars, Vrajema sarve sharanam yadisha, we very easily come under the shelter of your lotus feet, wherein we experience fearlessness, abhayam, because you are the giver of the fearlessness for your own surrendered devotees. So this is the glory of the process of bhakti that has been executed in relation to various avatars of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, which will award one sharanam and also abhayam, because the Lord is the giver of sharanam and abhayam. So this is spoken by Lord Ram in Ramayana. When Vibhishan was trying to surrender to Lord Ram, that time Lord Ram says that sakridevam prapannoyas tavasmiti cha yachate abhayam sarvada tasmai vratam yeta matam mama. So Lord says that even if a person says once also that, my dear Lord, I am yours, please take care of me, then Lord says that I am ready to offer fearlessness to that jiva for the rest of eternity, because this is my vow. So Lord is always eager to give us fearlessness and sharanam. And if we willingly surrender to Supreme Lord, we will be easily awarded that fearlessness and sharanam. That is the greatness of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So in the whole purport, Prabhupada talks about how Brahma, Shiva, Vishnu takes care of this creation, maintenance and annihilation of this world. And different variety of devotees serve them. That is explained in that purport.
Hare Krishna.
Yes, Maharaj.
Fearlessness here mentioned is fear of remaining in the cycle of birth and death. So one gets fearlessness of not remaining here. Is it the correct understanding what I am having?
No. Fearlessness is about Lord is my caretaker. Lord will take care of me. I don't have to worry about anything. Just like small kids, when they are with their children, with their parents, do they have any fear?
Okay.
So like that.
In the Arjuna, during the war, he was sleeping peacefully and Krishna was thinking what will happen next day. The same kind of thing.
Yeah, same kind of fearlessness.
Okay, thank you.
Anyone else has any query? So while the devotees are very easily surrendered to the lotus feet of Supreme Lord, there are many people who do not surrender to Supreme Lord. So first two verses talks about what is the reason that they don't surrender to Supreme Lord. And then in the next two verses, it says that if they happen to surrender to Supreme Lord, what kind of benefit they will get. So this is being mentioned in the next four verses. Verse number 44. यत्सानुबद्धे सति देहगेहे ममाहमिति वोढदुराग्रहानां पुंसां सुदूरं वसतोऽपि पुर्यां भजे मतत्ते भगवन् पदाब्जम्.
O Lord, persons who are entangled by undesirable eagerness for the temporary body and kingsmen, and who are bound by thoughts of mine and I, are unable to see your lotus feet, although your lotus feet are situated within their own bodies. But let us take shelter of your lotus feet.
So, why the surrender to Supreme Lord is not easy for others, that is mentioned here. Others means the non-devotees here. So, yet sa anubadde asati deha gehe mamaha miti uda duragrahanam. So sa anubadde asati deha gehe. Those who have taken shelter of asati things. Here asati means impermanent. Or one meaning of asati is also unchaste. So one who takes complete shelter of asati deha gehe. Deha means the material body. and geha means the home and everything connected to home, everything in relation to one's home. So the body itself is one's home, the home of atma. The house is the home for the atma along with the body. And in addition to the house, one has so many other things, so many residents in the house, like the all the other people connected to that person, and also so many furniture, so many objects, so many things in relation to house. So one who takes shelter of deha and geha, which are supposed to be asati, impermanent, and one consider them to be one's own life and soul, that person will always live with the understanding of mama and aham. This is me and all these are mine. The people who are living in this home are mine, and the objects that are there in the house are mine. Me and mine. A person is actually super overflooded with the consciousness of me and mine. Iti uda dura grahanam. Uda dura means very difficult to give up. And grahanam, he accepted that as one's own self. Person identifies oneself with the body and the house and all the other objects connected to the objects and people connected to the house. So for such people whose heart is filled with the conception of me and mine, pumsham suduram vashatopi puryam. Though the Supreme Personality of Godhead living in the heart of that person, living in the body of that person, Navadaha Pure Dehi, as Paramatma, but for that person whose heart is filled with, overflowed with me and mine, the Lord is actually situated at a far distance. Pumsham Suduram, the Lord is situated at a long, long distance. Bhajema Tatte Bhagavan Padabjam. Though they don't surrender to you, who is there in their heart as Paramatma, who is very close to them, but for them, their heart is filled with all other things. You are situated far distant. We take shelter of your lotus feet. So, of course, here devatas are offering, but in the last line, they say that we offer lotus shelter, we take shelter of your lotus feet. From their point of view, they're telling. But since these people are, their heart is filled with me and mine, they can't see the Supreme Lord who is situated in the heart. For such people, the Supreme Lord is located at a far distance. They can't even see him. So in that way, when the sun is set, he goes far. So we can't see him, something like that. So this same concept is mentioned in the second canto, fourth chapter, the beginning. The sages of Naimisharanya, Yeah, I think Sudha Goswami is only talking to the sages of Naimisharanya about the consciousness of Parikshit Maharaj. After hearing the first three chapters of Bhagavatam, the second canto, first three chapters from Sukadeva Goswami. So wherein he said that Atma Jaya Sutakara Pashu Dravina Bandushu Rajya Cha Vikala Nityam Virudam Mamatam Jehau. Virudam, uprooted from the very root. Parikshit Maharaj, having heard from Sukadeva Goswami the last two and a half chapters, one, two and third chapter, first half, he actually uprooted all the eight kinds of attachment a person has within one's heart. These eight are considered to be the deep-rooted attachment. What are the eight? Atma, attachment to one's own body. Jaya, one's own wife. Sutta, one's own children. Agara, one's own home. Pashu, animals that are connected to the house. Of course, in the previous days, people used to have animals for all the various purposes. Animals like horses, camels, elephants, cows, buffaloes, and all the variety of animals for various purposes. And then, nowadays, people have the vehicles. Pashu, Dravina, the wealth, bank balance, etc. Bandushu, the relatives, friends, Rajya. So this is connected, spoken in relation to Parikshit Maharaj. So he is a king. It is spoken as kingdom. But people of this world, Rajya means one's office, one's business, etc., etc. And Rajya cha vikale nityam. So these are the eight things. Atma, Jaya, Sutta, Agara, Pashu, Dravina, Bandushu and Rajya. So one's heart is filled with these eight things. But Parikshit Maharaj, having heard Srimad Bhagavatam, having taken shelter of the lotus feet of Sukadeva Goswami, he actually uprooted these eight deep-rooted attachments from the core of his heart. Then he could take shelter of the Supreme Lord very easily. So if the heart is occupied by these eight things, then there will be no place remained for Supreme Lord. So that is the understanding. That's how it is mentioned here. So Prabhupada writes, for what purpose this knowledge is revealed in Srimad Bhagavatam? The whole Vedic philosophy of life is that one should get rid of the material engagement of grass and subtle bodies, which only cause one to continue in a condemned life of miseries. The material body continues as long as one is not detached from these false conceptions of lording it over material nature. The impetus for lording it over material nature is the sense of me and mine, I and mine. So these things, in order to show to the world that I am this, I am so and so person, all these things are mine. I have so much money in bank balance, I have so much business, so many things, in order to tell that, we always after me and mine concept. That's how Bhagavatam describes. Persons conducted by such conception of life can never get liberation from material bondage. But even a person perpetually condemned to the miseries of material existence can get relief from bondage if he simply agrees to hear only Krishna Katha. In this age of Kali, the process of hearing Krishna Katha is the most effective means to gain release from unwanted family affection and thus find permanent freedom in life. So Prabhupada actually glorifies the Anga Bhakti, Shravanam, the importance of hearing Krishna Katha. So this is possible even for a person who is completely attached to Asati Deha Gehe. So then what else happens to them? It is mentioned that tan vaiya sadvritti birakshi birye parahrutantar manasa paresha ato na pashyanti urugaya nunam ete padanyasa vilasa laksha.
O great Supreme Lord, offensive persons whose internal vision has been too affected by the external materialistic activities cannot see your lotus feet, but they are seen by your pure devotees whose one and only aim is to transcendentally enjoy your activities.
So here in this verse, the one may question that, so why they can't see? It is said that devotees are always constantly traveling from place to place. They are always talking about bhakti. They can come across a devotee and then they can hear from a devotee and they can take to bhakti and then go back home back to Godhead. Why they can't do this? So this verse says that tanvai hi asad vrittibir akshibirye parahrutantar manasa paresha. Para ahrutantar antar manasa. Parahruta antar manasa. The inner mind, basically the man, buddhi, ahankara, chetana, the inner organs, the subtle elements, are actually parahruta. They are completely occupied. They are completely overpowered or overflooded by the conceptions of me and mine. So in order to increase one's me and mine, they take shelter of asadvrittibhi. Asadvritti, not the bona fide engagement of engaging in nine angas of bhakti. Instead, they engaging in various other activities wherein their me and mine can increase day by day. And they can't see anything beyond that. They can't see anything beyond this asad vritti. So such kind of people, though the devotees are constantly traveling around their home, singing the glories of the Supreme Lord, describing the pastimes of the Supreme Lord, atona pashyanti urugaya nunam. Urugaya, even though they are describing the wonderful activities and pastimes and Leela, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Atona Pashyanti, they can't even see, they can't even hear, because their ears and their heart are completely filled with how to increase me and mine. Ete Padanyasa Vilasa Lakshya. And these devotees who are constantly glorifying the Supreme Personality of Godhead, while doing that they are happy, and after ending this life, they'll go back to spiritual world and remain happy. So though the devotees are very happy around moving around them, they can't see them. They can't understand how to become happy in this world. Instead, they're only endeavoring hard to increase their me and my conceptions of life. So this is what happens when one's antar manas is completely overpowered by the conceptions of me and mine. So Prabhupada writes, Paramatma is situated in the heart of everyone. So it is very natural to be able to see the Lord at least within oneself. But that is not possible for those whose internal vision has been covered by external activities. Whose heart is completely filled with how to increase one's me and mine understanding in this world. So they can't see what the devotees, who the devotees are, what the devotees are doing, how the devotees are blissfully engaged in devotional service. Such kind of vision is not at all appearing. Though they see, they can't see. That is what the things. Transcendentalists who do not accept the Supreme Consciousness as separate from the individual consciousness are as offensive as the materialists who deny even the existence of the Lord. So basically, in the previous paragraph, Prabhupada talks about Atma and Paramatma is considered to be one by many of the transcendentalists. The impersonalists consider Atma and Paramatma to be one. Thus also, they can't see the Supreme Lord separately. That is also a problem. So like that. So such kind of people are considered to be offenders. The non-devotees and the impersonalists both are considered to be offenders. So because of the such kind of offense, they lose the opportunity to go back home back to Godhead and experience the bliss of serving the Supreme Personality of Godhead. That is not available to them. The offenders, however, lose the chance to receive the Lord's devotees. Although the offenseless common man is at once influenced by the devotee's presence. In this connection, there is an interesting story of a hunter and Devarshi Narada. Then Prabhupada briefly talks about the story of a hunter in the forest. Chaitanya Charitamrita talks about this hunter story. How Narada Muni comes and teaches him that why are you killing the animals half and enjoying the half-killed, suffering of the half-killed animals. The hunter says, this is what my father told me. Then Narada Muni told, either you kill, then he asked, why you are killing these animals like this? He said that for my livelihood. So Narada Muni says, if you get better livelihood, will you stop this? He said, okay. Then Narada Muni requested him to practice bhakti. As he practiced bhakti by becoming sadhu, the people of that nearby village, every day they brought whatever he needed. Even they brought more than what he needed. So he accepted whatever he needed, rest of the things he gave back in charity to all the visitors. So like that is the transformation happens in innocent. There are many people who are innocently doing so many akarmic activities, but when they come in touch with the devotees, when they receive the devotees with awe and respect, then their life becomes transformed. But those who can't see the devotees, who can't receive the devotees, their life cannot be transformed. So but when devotees, even they themselves come in the life of a person who does not want to see the devotees. So by the mercy of those devotees, their life changes. There is another example of Nalakuvera and Manigriva is mentioned in this Parapada by Srila Prabhupada. So such kind of people have to wait till their offense is rectified. Then the mercy of the devotee will act upon them, just like it acted on Nalakuvera Manigriva after some time, during which they have gone through the punishment of their offense. When that is done, they could witness all the wonderful pastimes of Lord Krishna, and by the mercy of Lord Krishna and the prayer of Narada Muni, Nalakuvera Manigriva got pure devotional service and they went back to Swarga to resume their services. So that is what is indicated in this purport. The Lord's devotees continue to bestow the blessings of devotion upon all such offenders without hesitation. That is the nature of devotees. So this is being mentioned in the beginning of this chapter only. Janasya Krishna Dvimukasya Devad Adharma Shilasya Tugudikitasya Anugrahayena Charanti Nunam Bhutani Bhavyani Janardanasya. So the devotees of the Supreme Lord, they are always eager to bestow their mercy upon the suffering conditioned souls of this world. That is their compassion toward the people of this material world. So though these two verses talks about the condition of grassly materialistic people, but if they happen to take shelter of the pure devotees, then what happens to them when they become devotees? what kind of transformation will take place in them. So that is mentioned in the next verse, verse number 46. Panena te deva kata sudhaya pravrudya bhaktya vishadaya yaye vairagya saram pratilabdha bodham etanjasun virakunta dishnyam.
O Lord, persons who, because of their serious attitude, attain the stage of enlightened devotional service, achieve the complete meaning of renunciation and knowledge, and attain the Vaikuntha Loka in the spiritual sky simply by drinking the nectar of your topics.
So when such kind of people who are attached to things of this world, but if they happen to come in the shelter of pure devotees, when they happen to drink the nectar of Krishna Katha, Panena te deva katha sudaya. Panena means drinking. Katha sudaya means the nectar of Krishna Katha. Pravrudya bhaktya vishadashayaye. So by the such hearing, the bhakti will manifest in their heart. And when bhakti manifests in their heart, the heart becomes freed of all materialistic desires. Vishada ashaya. Ashaya means the aims in relation to the accumulation of vishaya, the sense objects, the objects that give one material pleasure. So one becomes indifferent to all such things. And this is the essence of bhakti. This is vairagya saram. The essence of vairagya is detachment to the things of this material world and attachment to Krishna Katha. Pratilabdha bodham. And then when one becomes detached to the things of this material world, the knowledge in relation to spiritual world will manifest in that heart. Etanja sunvir akunta dishnam. Such kind of people executing the nine angas of bhakti very easily. Anjasa, eta, anjasa, unviyur akunta dishnam. They very easily go back home back to Godhead. Akunta dishnam means the abode of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, the Vaikuntha abodes. They will go back to Godhead by executing such bhakti under the shelter of bona fide representative of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So this is the glory of bhakti. This is how bhakti acts upon the innocent. Though they are attached to material things, but when they take shelter of pure devotees, they are going back home back to Godhead is sure. Very easily, they will go back home back to Godhead. So this is actually indicated in the second canto many places. If you remember, we discussed these verses in the second canto, fourth chapter, where Sukadeva Goswami was offering prayers before starting a serial discussion with Parikshit Maharaj, wherein Parikshit Maharaj asked various questions in relation to creation of this material world. That is where Sukadeva Goswami offers a wonderful prayers, wherein he says that Kirata Hunandra Pulinda Pulkasha Abhira Shumba Yavana Kashadaya Ye Annacha Papa Yadapashraya Ashraya Shuddhati Tasmai Prabhavishnave Namaha. All these people, Kirata, Huna, Andhra, Pulinda, Pulkasha, Abhira, Shumba, Yavana, Kasha, etc. Annacha, Papa, Yadapashraya, Ashraya. Even if they are any other people who are actually immersed in Papa activities, Yadapashraya, Ashraya. If they happen to take shelter of someone who has taken shelter of your lotus feet, by such surrender, Shuddhyanti Tasmai, their heart becomes purified immediately. Shuddhyanti Tasmai Prabhavishnave Namaha. Because you are so glorious, and hence your devotees also become so glorious, that by taking shelter of such devotees who are taking shelter of your lotus feet, these people, even though they are born in all these sinful families, Kirata, Huna, Andhra, Pulinda, Pulkasha, etc., even though they have taken birth in good families only, but they taken shelter of sinful activities, both the kind of people becomes purified very soon. That is the glory of your devotional service. The same thing is further mentioned in one of the previous verses of the same chapter, 2.4.15, wherein Sukadeva Goswami says that Yat kirtanam yat smaranam yat ikshanam yat vandanam yat shravanam yat artnam yat arhanam लोकस्य सद्यो विदिनोति कल्मषं तस्मै सुभद्राश्रवसे नमो नमः. Here the glories of various angas of bhakti are mentioned. Kirtanam, smaranam, darshanam, vandanam, shravanam and arahanam, archana. By doing all these things or any one of these things, lokadya sadyo vidunoti kalmasham, the people of this world becomes cleansed of all the misgivings very easily. Or sadyo means immediately they become purified of all the contaminations of this world. So that is possible by executing in various angas of bhakti. This is the glories of devotional service. The same thing Lord Brahma also mentioned in the second, seventh chapter of the second canto, wherein we said that tevai vidanti yat taranti cha deva mayam trishudra huna apipapa sabara apipapa jiva yadi adbhuta karma parayana shila shikshas tereyak jano kimuta suddharanaya. Tevai vidanti atitaranti cha devamayam. Devamayam means mahamaya. So such people who take shelter of your lotus feet, they very easily cross over the influence of maya. Who can cross over? Sri, Shudra, Huna, Sabara, Api Papa Jiva. All the Papa Jivas are Sri, Shudra, Huna, Sabara, all these people. Yadi, if at all, Adbhuta Krama Parayana Shila Shikshas. Adbhuta Krama is the supreme personality of God at Narayana. And Parayana, Narayana Parayana Shila Shikshas. If they take Shiksha from Narayana Parayana, they can very easily go back home back to God. Even animals, if they take shelter of Tiryak Jana, even animals, if they take shelter of such a pure devotee, they will go back home back to God. Then what to speak of human beings who can hear and understand and execute all the activities? It is very easy for the human beings to go back home back to Godhead. So that is what is indicated by Lord Brahma also. Same Lord Brahma also mentions the same chapter 2742. He says that Esham sa esha bhagavan dayaye dananta sarvatma nashita pado yati nirvelikam te dustaram matitaranchita maya deva mayam naisham mamahamiridi swashrugala bhakshe. So those who take shelter of the supreme lotus feet of the supreme personality of Godhead without any pretensions, they very easily cross over the maya and go back home back to Godhead. But this is not possible for those people who are always in the thought process of mama and aham, aham mameti. They end up becoming the food for dogs and jaggers. When they end their life, their body becomes food for dogs and swashrugala baksha, dogs and jackals. So that is the end of those who always live in the conception of me and mine, considering asati deha geha to be permanent. So that is how we can see the entire Bhagavatam mainly focuses about how we should become detached from the temporary and become attached to the permanent. So these things are always keep coming again and again in the Srimad Bhagavatam. So we need to hear such kind of things again and again to remind ourselves. So what should be the priority in our life? So in that way, the devotee has only to hear about devotional activities, which are as simple as anything in ordinary life. And he also acts very simply, whereas the mental speculator has to pass through a jugglery of words, which are practical, which are partially facts and partially a make show for the maintenance of an artificial impersonal status. In spite of his strenuous efforts to attain perfect knowledge, the impersonalist attains merging into the impersonal oneness of the Brahma Jyoti of the Lord, which is also attained by the enemies of the Lord simply because of their being killed by the Supreme Lord. The devotees, however, attain to the highest stage of knowledge and renunciation and achieve the Vaikuntha Loka, the planets in the spiritual sky. Actually, Prabhupada actually combines this verse and next verse and gives the purport here itself. So whatever Prabhupada is talking here about the impersonalist is explained in the next verse. About that, Prabhupada talks about here only. So the impersonalist, though after a hard struggle, they only enter into Brahma Jyoti, which is also obtained by the demons killed by the Supreme Lord. But the devotees go beyond Brahma Jyoti and enter into Vaikuntha Loka, where they have the opportunity to serve the Supreme Lord continuously and experience the bliss of serving the Supreme Personality of God. So that is possible for the devotees. So that is how the execution of bhakti and execution of jnana or yoga is different. So this verse describes about taking shelter of bhakti by the innocent. And if the innocent takes shelter of jnana and yoga, then what happens to them? That is explained in the next verse, verse number 47.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji.
Yes, Prabhu.
This is before creation has happened, before the living entities are there and everything is there. So how do the demigods know that who is going to be a jnani, who is going to be a devotee, who is not going to be a devotee?
See, creation is continuously happening.
Okay.
In the last creation, all these things are happening. And these are the eternal Asura, the Supreme Lord. The Ete Deva Kala Pumsha. They are Kala of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So they know what is going to happen in the material world. They have complete knowledge. They don't forget. They are not ordinary jivas. Though they are appearing in this material world in the form of devatas at the very beginning, in order to assist the Supreme Lord for creating this material universe and all the living entities, but they are all empowered expansion of the Supreme Lord. They are all Shakti Avesh avataras. So they know all the knowledge. So they are praying.
Prabhuji, do the devatas remain the same throughout the creation or do they keep on changing the post?
No, they keep on changing. Every manvantara they keep changing.
Every manvantara?
Obviously.
71 years.
After 71 years, they keep changing. Yeah. Even these devatas, they did not stay for long. They came, they assisted the Supreme Lord when as the Lord was creating all the living entities. After giving responsibility to some jivas who are going to stay in this material world for a long time, they gave the responsibility and they went back. Even these the devatas, they are expansions of Lord Vishnu. They are assisting Lord at the very beginning. They also did not stay for the entire duration of one manvantara. They are there along with the Lord only for some time. And they went back immediately giving responsibility to the jivas who are going to live in that universe. So in that way.
Thank you so much, Prabhu.
Anyone else? Any query?
Hare Krishna.
Hi.
There is some confusion in what you explained right now. Like those devatas who are the considered as devatas of the elements, that you mean are the expansion of the Lord himself. Because till now devatas are not created. Afterwards, Brahma creates no other devatas. So
That is all other devatas. We are just talking about these 14 devatas who are created along with the elements, along with the 14 elements.
Okay, so those are expansions of the Lord itself.
Yeah. Yes.
And they go back once they find some particular jiva who are able to take responsibility, they go back to the eternal world.
Yeah, most of them will go back, some will remain.
Okay, thank you.
Correct. So why they will go back, how they will go back, we'll get a hint about. There is no direct mention in the Bhagavatam, but we get a hint about it in the fourth canto, wherein it talks about all the devatas during Swayambhu Manvantara period, all the devatas, how they appear, because they take birth through various people. So that means if these people are already there, why there is a mention about another Indra, another devatas? So because these people are Lord Vishnu's expansions, they were there till they find a suitable candidate. When a suitable candidate was found, that candidate was given responsibility and they will go back. So, in that way. So, now, the next verse, verse number 47.
Tata pare chatma samadhi yoga balena jitva prakritim balishtam tvameva dira purusham vishanti
Others who are purified by means of transcendental self-realization and have conquered over the modes of nature by dint of strong power and knowledge also enter into you. But for them, there is much pain. Whereas the devotee simply discharges devotional service and thus feels no such pain.
So, tata apare, others, those who does not want to practice bhakti, those who don't want to go back to Vaikuntha and serve the Supreme Lord. So, those who want to practice jnana and yoga and enter into Brahman, So all they are included in tata apare. Tata apare. Other than those devotees. Cha, Atma Samadhi Yoga. By taking shelter of Jnana and Ashtanga Yoga, they work very hard. Balena, they work very hard. Jitva Prakrutim Balishtam. They actually conquer the powerful Maya, the powerful Prakriti, Prakriti Balishtam. And Tvam Eva Dhira Purusham Vijanti. And they are also called as Dhira, being determined by working very hard. Tvameva Vishanti, my dear Lord, they will enter into you, known as Brahman. Because that is their desire to enter into Brahman. So by working very hard, by practice of Jnana and Ashtanga Yoga, they conquer the influence of material Maya and then they enter into Brahman. Tvameva Purusham Vishanti, they will enter and take shelter in Brahman. Tesham Shrimasyan, but they have to go through intense endeavor. They have to go through hard labor. Natu Seva Yate, which is not required for the devotees who are engaged in your service. Even while executing sadhana, after going back home back to Godhead also, in both the places, the devotees don't go through any endeavor because the execution of sadhana itself gives them the pleasure. Execution of nine angas of bhakti is always giving them pleasure. But the execution of Jnana and Yoga involves intense hard labor. They may not experience so much pleasure while executing Jnana and Yoga. But when they enter into Brahman, they may experience Brahmananda. But this Brahmananda also is incomparable to the bliss of Vaikuntha Ananda. But the devotees are always experiencing pleasure while executing bhakti and after going back home back to Godhead, wherein they are going to serve the Supreme Lord in person directly. In both the cases, they are actually experiencing happiness. This is not the case with non-devotees. Those who are taken shelter of Jnana and Yoga, this is not the case. So this is how they are actually comparing the hard work involved in relation to bhakti and in relation to other processes. So Prabhupada writes the same thing. Prabhupada continues the same thing. In terms of labor of love and it is written, the bhaktas or devotees of the Lord always have priority over persons who are addicted to the association of jnanis or impersonalists and yogis or mystics. They have to go through hard labor. This is confirmed in the Bhagavad Gita also, 12th chapter. Klesho adhikarastesham avyakta asakta chesta avyaktahi gatir dukkam dehavadir avyapesen. So in that way. One may suggest that there is sufficient labor for the devotees also in the matter of discharging devotional service. Devotees also have to go through hard labor, but that labor is compensated by the enhancement of transcendental pleasure. The devotees derive more transcendental pleasure while engaging continuously in the service of the Lord than when they have no such engagement. As explained in the previous verse, the destination of the devotees is Vaikuntha or Akunta Dishna, the place where anxieties are completely eradicated. One should not mistake the destination of the devotees and that of the impersonalist to be one and the same. The destinations are distinctly different and the transcendental pleasure derived by the devotees is also distinct from chin matra or spiritual feelings alone. The Vaikuntha happiness is different from Brahmananda. So that is what is indicated here. So this is how when the innocent people, they take shelter of bhakti, what will happen to them? And when they take shelter of jnana or yoga, what will happen to them? So that is being indicated by the devatas here in these two verses. So now the devatas are also hinting about themselves. While speaking about the people of this world, they are talking about themselves. Tesham shremosyan natu seva yate. They are telling that, my dear Lord, we are also created by you. Just like devotees, even though going through hard work while engaging in your service, they don't experience any pain, any trouble. But the devotees, when they don't have opportunity to engage in devotional service, they actually go through intense misery, intense anxiety, intense pain. Similarly, we currently have been created by you, but we don't have any service to render unto you. Because we don't have any seva, natu seva yate, Tesham Shrima. We're actually going through intense anxiety, intense pain. Please relieve us from this painful situation by engaging us in your transcendental service. So this is their prayer to the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So while explaining about the people of this world who become devotees, who become jnanis and yogis, they are also giving a hint about their own condition that they make clear in the next verse. In the next verse, they say that, please engage us in your service. Tatte vayam lokasi srikshayadhyā tvayāna srishta tribhi tvayāna srishta tribhi rātna bhīsmā sarve vikunta svavihāra tantram nashaknumastha pratihārta vete. Someone read the translation.
O original person, we are therefore but yours only. Although we are your creatures, we are born one after another under the influence of the three modes of nature. And for this reason, we are separated in action. Therefore, after the creation, we could not act concretely for your transcendental pleasure.
So here they say that tatte vayam loka sisruksha yadya tvayan srishtas tribiratna bhisma. O Lord, with a desire to create the material universes, you have created us along with the 24 elements. Tatte vayam loka sisruksha yadya. Loka sisruksha yadya means in order to create all the variety of universes. Tvaya anusrishtas, you have created all of us along with the 24 elements, in three divisions, tribiratna visma, in the mode of goodness, in the mode of passion, in the mode of ignorance. The elements are categorized into mode of goodness, passion, and ignorance. That mind is in the mode of goodness, intelligence in the mode of passion, senses are also in the mode of passion, and the grass elements and tarmatras in the mode of ignorance, like that. So you have created us and the elements in three different modes. Sarve viyunta swavihara tantram na shaknumas tat pratihartave te sarve viyunta. Though we are created in terms of in the form of 24 elements and the 14 devatas, because all of us are positioned in different places, we don't know what to do. Because we are situated separately, independently of each other, sarve viyunta vikta, we are not yukta, viyukta. We are actually differentiated, we are differently situated, we are not connected together. Sva vihara tantram na shaknumastat pratiharta vete. As long as we are situated separately, we can't create this universe for your pleasure. Sva vihara tantram, the purpose with which you are creating this material world is for your vihara, for your transcendental pleasure. So vihara means as a plaything, as an object of play. So we can't make the object of play for your play. We can't create this universe as long as you cannot unite us together. As long as all of us are disunited, so we cannot do anything for your service. So please empower us to become united and do something for you, so that we can engage in your service. Indirectly they are telling that, please engage us in your service so that we can create this universe, which is your vihara tantram, with your object of play. So this is the request of the devatas. So the devatas continue the same request in the next three verses. So Lord asks, how exactly you want to serve me? How exactly you want to create that Sva Vihara Tantram, the object of my play? What is in your heart? What is in your mind? Please tell me in clarity. Clearly, please tell me. Then they say in the next verse, what exactly is there in their heart?
Yavad balinte jaharama kale yata vayam chanyam adama hetra yatobayesham tai mehi loka balim haranto namada adantanuha.
O unborn one, please enlighten us regarding the ways and means by which we can offer you all enjoyable grains and commodities so that both we and all other living entities in this world can maintain ourselves without disturbance and can easily accumulate the necessities of life, both for you and for ourselves.
So here, the devatas clarify what is there in their heart. They say that yavat balin teja harama kale. Aja means, O unborn, the supreme transcendental personality of Godhead. My dear Lord, who you are unborn, yavat balinte harama kale. They say that we should be able to offer the articles for your play at suitable time. Yavat balim means whatever is needed for your play, we should be able to offer you at a suitable time. And also at suitable time, bali also refers to the offerings of food grains, offerings of foodstuffs, offerings of bhoga. That also we should be able to offer to you at the prescribed time. So this is one desire of ours. Then yata vayam chanya madama yatra, and similarly, after offering you the suitable objects of articles and suitable objects of eatables, we should also be able to accept the food that we need, the articles of play that we need. First, let us offer to you the articles of play and the items of foodstuffs, and then we'll accept the articles of play and items of food for our nourishment. And here, the devatas are telling in terms of there. And then they talk about in terms of all the living entities in this material world. Yatova yeshamtai imehi loka balim haranto annam adanti anuha. And then all the living entities headed by Brahma in this material world, let they offer all the eatables and all the articles of play unto both you and us. Yata ubaya esham. Let the living entities of this world, let they offer all the variety of articles of play and all the variety of eatables unto you first and then unto us. By the performance of Vijna Dana Tapa, by executing all the variety of sacrifices performed by karmis, by performance of all the variety of activities of jnana and practiced by jnanis, and all the activities of yoga by the practitioners of Ashtanga yoga. So like that, whatever they do, let they offer unto you and then unto us, so that both you and we get our food at respectable time. By such offering, by execution of yajna, jnana and yoga, the people of this world who are practicing nishkama karma yoga, jnana and ashtanga yoga will go back to Godhead. So basically, that is, let us establish a bona fide means by which we will get our eatables and the things for play, and the people of this world doing the same thing, they will go back to Godhead. So we want to create a universe in which becomes your plaything, in which we will also have something to do as an offering to you, in which the people, when they offer both to you and us, they will also go back to Godhead. So we want to create such a universe which will benefit both you and us and also all the living entities. So thus, they are indicating in this verse. So here actually they indicate two things. Yata vayam chanya madama yatra. So while telling this, they are telling that we as 24 elements who become the material bodies of all the living entities want to eat food and nourish ourselves. The 24 elements within our body are nourished when we eat food. When we actually eat food, our body is nourished. And the Atma which is there in the heart of this body is nourished when we actually execute Nishkama Karma Yoga or Jnana Yoga or Ashtanga Yoga or Bhakti Yoga. The Nishkama Karma Yoga is perform Yajnas. The Jnana Yoga is perform Tapasya. The Ashtanga yogis perform the eight limbed yoga and devotees perform nine angas of bhakti. When they perform all these things as an offering to Supreme Lord, the Supreme Lord gelds his boga. The devatas get their boga and the people, the jivas who are practicing these things will get purified and go back to Godhead. So they want to establish a universe which will have all these things. So this is what the desire of the devatas, the present it is of the 14 elements. So this is what is expressed by all these people, all these devatas. So thus they are going to request the Lord for proper empowerment so that they can do all these things. First they are expressing that what they want to do. So then Prabhupada talks about the location of the devatas. The devatas are actually situated in the heavenly planets which are located above our Bhuloka. So they are actually more advanced in culture, enjoyment, luxury, beauty, education, and duration of life. They are always fully God conscious. Such devatas are always ready to render service to Supreme Lord because they are perfectly aware of the fact that every living entity is continuously an eternal subordinate servitor of the Lord. They also know that it is the Lord only who can maintain all the living entities with all the necessities of life. एको बहुनाम यो विदधाति कामान् तयेनम अब्रुवन् आयतनाम न प्रजानीहि यस्मिन् प्रतिष्ठिता अन्नम अदामहे. सो दिस इज व्हाट इज इंडिकेटेड हियर, अन्नम अदामहे. सो दे आर एक्चुअली टेलिंग द लॉर्ड दैट प्लीज प्रोवाइड अस अ यूनिवर्स वेयर इन वी कैन गेट टू ईट. When the people of this world offer their oblation in the form of yajna, dana, tapa, etc., etc. So this is the prayer of the devatas. So then Prabhupada talks about how Lord maintains everyone. The starvation is actually a creation of the materialistic people. Because the Lord is the maintainer of every living entity. Lord maintains everyone, whoever is created. There will be no starvation if everyone lives in Krishna consciousness. Because people have no Krishna consciousness, that's why people are actually suffering. So that is indicated in Bhagavad Gita 3:13, wherein Lord Krishna says that when we offer everything to Supreme Lord and accept the remnants, so we are freed from the sin. But when we accept without offering to Supreme Lord, we are only eating sin, because of which the greediness will increase in some people, because of which others will suffer. That is the condition of this world. That is the condition of the people of this world. So that is what is indicated. Now in the next verse, they actually glorify the Supreme Lord and they also pray for the mercy of the Supreme Lord. These are the two verses wherein they are going to offer prayers to Supreme Lord and seek for his mercy and empowerment so that they can do whatever they are indicated in the previous two verses, whatever they want to do. So any queries till now? Hare Krishna. Any queries? So if there are no queries, we'll take 5 minutes break, then we'll continue after the